This is the Sandman Podcast on TV Podcast Industries. We're talking about the Sandman Chapter 9, Collectors.
What you looking for?
It's a cereal convention. I thought there'd be cereal.
Are you still hungry? Okay, well, have a seat over there and we'll get you something to eat.
Tell you, I could murder a steak. Good bloody steak.
They do this chocolate fudge whip that's to die for.
The TV version butchered it, but you can find it uncut online.
Oh, all right.
I thought this whole issue was dead and buried in the 60s.
That's when Harry killed the lights. I could have died.
He slays me, that guy.
Welcome back, fellow dreamers. This is TV Podcast Industries, and we're discussing The Sandman Chapter 9, Collectors. I'm one of your hosts, Derek.
Hello there, fellow dreamers. I am one of your other hosts, John.
Squeezing in our final podcast before we head off on holidays, and unfortunately, Chris still isn't with us for this episode of The Sandman.
No, exactly.
Sorry, Chris. We had to crack on and get this done so that we'd have an episode coming out while we're away on holidays.
Yeah, exactly.
So right now, hopefully, we'll be sitting on a beach as you listen to this podcast.
Yes. Feel the Mai Tais, the wave of Mai Tai crashing against my mouth.
Excellent.
I guess.
Not your thighs, thankfully.
No, not my thighs.
That's if you have a drinking problem and you miss your mouth. Exactly. Good stuff. If you're listening to our Sandman podcast, I hope you're subscribed to our main podcast feed. You can find that over on tvpodcastindustries.com or just by searching TV Podcast Industries on any dreaming or nightmarish podcast catcher. You can also send any feedback to us to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com, or if you want to leave any thoughts on any of the shows that we cover, we also have a spoiler post on our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries, where you can leave your thoughts about any of the shows we're covering, and we'll cover them on a future podcast.
Yeah, good stuff. With the public service announcement out of the way, dreamers, let us crack on with our spoiler-filled chat about Chapter 9, mm-hmm. Collectors.
Yeah, it's almost the penultimate episode, but because they released that extra episode, we're actually got two more episodes to go after this one, John.
I know.
Yeah.
But well, two half episodes, I guess.
Yeah, yeah. I've already watched them, and it's kind of a quarter and three quarters.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not exactly halves, but looking forward to talking about that one as well. But we still have the rest of this story of the Doll's House arc from the comic books continuing on. So we're talking about the ninth episode of The Sandman Collectors. The executive producers for this show are Alan Heinberg, Neil Gaiman, and David S. Gore. This episode was written by Vanessa Benton, who's been a staff writer in the show for the entire season.
Excellent stuff. Glad we've got Vanessa writing away there for everyone and getting now her own episode with Chapter 9.
Yep. And this episode was directed by Coralie Fargeat. Coralie is a French film director, and this is her first episode of The Sandman.
Well, excellent stuff. Welcome on board, Coralie, to the production and crew of The Sandman, I guess.
Yeah. It would definitely be remiss of me to call out how much I wanted to write down Coraline, because she spells it almost exactly the same as the Neil Gaiman character, Coraline. So only one letter difference. So thanks. Thanks very much for putting that wonderful book back in my head, Coraline. John, do you want to tell us what they gave us with your synopsis for The Sandman Chapter 9, Collectors?
Sure. Lyta's pregnancy and sex life with her dead husband are causing tremors in the dreaming. With fault lines forming across the realm, including in Morpheus's palace, Lucienne and Matthew deduce that it is the result of Rose's increasing power, which threatens to weaken and break down the barriers between the dreaming and the waking world. But Morpheus is unsure of the theory. Meanwhile, Lyta continues to meet Hector in her dreams and finds that her pregnancy is advancing at a rapid rate. Back at Hal's bed and breakfast, Rose receives a call from the Corinthian, who tells her that he has Jed safe and sound, and she can collect him from the Royal Hotel in Georgia, where he is to give the keynote speech at the cereal convention, with a distinct absence of cereal. Jed also notices a lack of cereal, his favourite food, as he explores the convention centre, despite instructions from Corinthian to stay in his room. Jed continues to explore the hotel and strikes up a conversation with one of the collectors, Funland. Rose travels to the hotel to meet them, accompanied by her kindly upstairs neighbour, Gilbert. As Gilbert's literary discussions send Rose off to the land of Nod, where she arrives into Lyta's dream separately from Morpheus, who has also arrived to discern what is happening. He realizes that Rose, as the Vortex, has allowed Hector's spirit to inhabit the dreaming, in lieu of him passing on to the afterlife. Despite the protests from Lyta and anger from Rose, Morpheus banishes Hector from the dreaming and informs Lyta that her unborn child will one day belong to him, because it was conceived in the dreaming. Rose and Gilbert arrive at the hotel and search for Jed. While searching, the Corinthian and Gilbert recognize each other, causing Gilbert to flee to the dreaming, where he is revealed to be the personified Fiddler's Green, one of the other rogue dreaming residents. Gilbert relays the Corinthian and Rose's location to Morpheus. Alone, Rose continues her search for her brother, and crashes into a distraught and terrified Jed, being helped by Funland as he flees from witnessing exactly who the Corinthian really is. But Funland isn't willing to give up his new prize, and hunts Jed and Rose until the Corinthian swiftly dispatches him and has the siblings all to himself.
Ooh, lots of big stuff in this final reveal of who Gilbert is.
Yes.
The gentleman upstairs. We guess the Corinthian and some of the other collectors at the serial convention, which is a great fun to see. A serial convention without any children, you're missing out on a prime target audience.
I know, exactly.
Really good stuff. And of course, this kind of butting of heads between the Vortex and Morpheus.
Oh, definitely. Yeah, I know that felt like another seismic shift here in terms of how Rose perceived Morpheus, for sure. Yeah. And I mean, it was also quite brutal what Morpheus did in front of Lyta and Rose as well, despite all their protests. So, Morpheus's sort of douchebaggery knows no bounds here. At the same time, I now appreciate that he does have to police his realm, and this is one of those hard choices which impacts Lyta. So again, another really good episode for me. Mm-hmm. Really enjoyed it, including, I guess, as we kick off with our top moments from Chapter 9. Mm-hmm. It is the running gag of the serial convention.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Finally seeing this brought to life. It's a little more hidden in the comics. Interestingly, you don't really understand what the serial convention is, because, of course, it's spelt like serial, not serial killer. But the joke of it is there as you realize that all of these people are killers. There's a touch of it or a nod to it as Jed and the Corinthian arrive, and you see all the rest of the guests that are there, and the way that they're talking about everything from the power being dead to all the conversations that they're having, even about the most mundane things. Each one of them has a line that sounds really brutal if taken out of context, which is the kind of way that it was dealt with in the comic books. So I like that they at least kept that touch there, even though we've already seen the other collectors trying to get Corinthian on board as the central speaker at the serial convention. But I love how it all played out. I really, really enjoyed this idea of having a convention for serial killers, all trying to share their tips with each other. And I think particularly having Rose and Gilbert, who I don't really know how they actually got into the serial convention. They were stopped at the door by Funland. He tells them that he sees everybody going in, and then they just steal some badges and get in. But it doesn't really matter. It leads to some great fun moments with Gilbert as he goes into some of the presentations, like making money at this game is one of them, where the absolutely horrible serial killers are saying, well, you can sell some information about your victims back to the family, and that will at least keep the bills ticking over. But don't do it for the money, you do it for the murders themselves. But the realization creeping over Gilbert's face as he understands what some of these people are talking about, the panel about women's work and about that, about why they are just as equal in serial killing as the men is really funny as
absolutely.
Well.
Absolutely.
But mostly for the reaction from Gilbert for the horrible things that are coming out of these people's mouths, you know.
That's it. I just absolutely loved this creeping realization from Gilbert as he starts to get the gist of actually what is going on at this serial convention.
Mm-hmm.
You know, to his own horror. And that horror sort of gradually building on his face. You know, it started off quizzical.
Yeah.
And by the end of it, it's just outright terror.
Yeah.
And then, of course, he spots the Corinthian.
Mm-hmm.
And, yeah, I mean, you see it with the Corinthian thinking, I recognize that person.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's the sense you're thinking of Rose, that, you know, he's been close to Rose.
Mm-hmm.
But ultimately, we get then this reveal as he effectively drops Rose. I mean, I guess he's terrified of the Corinthian because he knows exactly who he is. And I can understand why he would want to turn and run. But the fact that he turns and runs without getting Rose first and just simply leaving a note behind reception. It felt, now come on, Gilbert, you could have at least sort of done something, because at the, you know, in that moment, you didn't quite know other than from what he had heard, and that's why he was running, and you're like going, so you're leaving Rose to a serial killer convention, effectively, and you know it.
And you know it.
Rather than him being Fiddler's Green, but then you get that reveal that he is Fiddler's Green, and he heads back to the dreaming, which I just really loved this turn of events. I thought it was just really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
And it's also connected with the apology that Morpheus gives to Lucienne as well. And to say that with the dreaming, she was right. And Lucienne, as the diplomat, says, but so were you, my lord, you know, still there. But he effectively, in his own way, apologizes. And firstly, the reveal of Fiddler's Green is Gilbert.
Mm-hmm.
Morpheus doesn't seem quite as angry with Fiddler's Green, maybe because he came back under his own steam, even though it was with the sheer fright of seeing the Corinthian.
Yes.
But you get the other reveal here from them. And the shock from Gilbert, because in order to stop this weakening of the barrier between the dreaming and the waking world that Morpheus has now experienced, and which Lucienne and Matthew were kind of trying to sort of, you know, deduce.
Yeah.
Gilbert, or Fiddler's Green, says, you know, Morpheus is going to have to kill Rose Walker.
Yes, absolutely.
Which is like a big dun dun dun.
It's a big moment. It's a massive moment. And especially because of how close Gilbert's gotten with Rose as well. He's suddenly really fearful for her, but knows this is what has to happen. And that kind of explains why he ran away and left Rose behind. Remember, Rose's concern is getting her brother back. It's one human getting another human back. That's their only concern. The ramifications of what Fiddler's Green has just seen there, which is that the Corinthian is alive and well and murdering humans across the planet and inspiring massive other amounts of serial killers to go out and kill other humans, which I'm really glad they paid off in this episode from a little comment earlier on in the season, that they were all inspired by the Corinthian. He's brought this to the world, effectively, is the concept of what's happening here, that he's inspired so many more people than would have been inspired by anybody else because of what he's been doing for 120 years or 100 years here on Earth. But that's much more important to Fiddler's Green as a member of the Dreaming, reporting this back to the Dream King, the Dream Lord, that this is what he's seen.
Yeah.
Than just dealing with the incidental issue of one girl trying to find her younger brother, you know. So while it seems a bit callous that he just runs off leaving a note behind, at least he left a note, but while it seems a bit callous, there's a much bigger stakes at play in the background here. And that can be said a little bit for Morpheus again. I'm going to be slightly defending him, I feel, in this episode a bit. But it is about the bigger picture for these entities and what they are trying to look after. What do you think of the reveal of Fiddler's Green as being Gilbert or Gilbert?
Yeah, it was great. Totally in plain sight. Really loved it. I mean, should have at least have had some suspicion around it, given A, it's Stephen Fry. Mm-hmm. So,
magnificent.
You know, magnificent. probably being more than the literary guy upstairs, but also he wore green as well. So that was a little bit of a giveaway, I guess.
I'm consistently saying that she's drawing all the dreams to him and him only appearing at certain times and not being around all the time. There's a really good nod to it. It's early on in this episode, of course. So by the end of the episode, you know it's Fiddler's Green, but a great nod to it when she says to him, is this your first time in America? Are you from England? And he says, why do you say that? And he says, well, you sound English. And he goes, well, thank you very much for that. But there's no indication that he's traveled over from England to America. He describes it as going to another land from his home and then says he has to go home. So he's talking about transferring over from the dreaming to America and then back to dreaming again.
Exactly. So
nice little nods there that you can catch in the way he delivers.
You know, in hindsight, at least for me on the second watch, it was it was really good. Just absolutely loved it. I mean, this was really good. And as you say, the serial convention as well. Just all the different characters there playing different serial killers. Really, you know, we've seen Funland and Nimrod and the Doctor before. Really just great to have them back being creepy. Just everyone else, you know, as you see them, you know, various stages walking along the corridors, you know, and then you see them sort of up on the dais with others on a panel discussion about it as Gilbert is going into them to try and find Jed. So I just really like that whole feel, and even with the fact that there is this interloper in the boogeyman that's not the boogeyman. It's a guy that writes, a fanboy effectively, called Philip Sitz. And despite the initial introduction by Nimrod to the convention, you know, the usual stuff of keep your mobiles off, exits here, and don't shit where you eat. They have to shit where they eat and collect Philip Sitz, which is because Corinthian has taken a particular fancy to this serial killer. At least that's what it looks like initially, but he is the one that knows that this is not the boogeyman.
Exactly, and I love the rising tension that is within this. You know, this is almost like an episode of Hannibal at times. It's that kind of idea of you're in a room surrounded by serial killers and you're pretending to be one of them to get your interviews, to get your information out of them. You are in a really terrifying situation, and the second they find out who you are, you're going to be killed, Philip. You know, he was not a very smart kid. He calls out quite quickly to the Corinthian a connection to the blog that he used to write, effectively, and that's how they find out who he is. But what a terrifying position to be in, to be suddenly surrounded by serial killers all around you.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I mean, as well, I really enjoyed Jed. You know, cereal, one of his favorite foods. Mm-hmm. He's come to a cereal convention and, you know, having been locked down in the cellar of his foster home, he's then being told to just stay in the bedroom. Mm-hmm. And, you know, curiosity killed the cat, and his kind of drive to go and explore to see where his savior, effectively, the person that's rescued him, what he's doing, and you know, that. The one person he strikes up a conversation with is Funland, and you're just no. And it is just so creepy, but just so well done. You know, the innocence of Jed, but also knowing that Funland is grotesque and has very different motivations and thoughts about Jed. And, you know, Jed's kind of looking for a free sample of cereal, effectively.
Exactly. Yeah.
I like also the fact that Jed, in exploring the convention, is going against the Corinthians' wishes. And so he does hide. He's pretty sneaky about it. You know, there's that moment where you think he's just spotted Jed, but it's another kid.
Yeah.
So I kind of liked all that, and I liked how this was all constructed within the convention. And suddenly as Gilbert and Rose arrive, just, you know, kind of missing one another, or not finding Jed, but it then connecting in with both Nimrod, the Doctor, and Corinthian killing Philip Sitz, with Jed seeing, and how in the end Rose and Jed finally find one another.
Yeah.
But it's still not safe because Jed's with Funland, who sees this as an opportunity to effectively murder Jed here.
Yeah. He's not willing to let him go. He's done the work now. He's mine, kind of thing. Yeah, it's really creepy, but especially because you've layered in earlier on his description of how he gets his victims. You've had that idea he calls himself Funland because that's where he spends his time, picking off children whose parents have left them alone, you know. It's really creepy, and I love how he delivers it. He is such a perfect translation. If I show you the page in the comic book, you can see this is exactly the character from the comic book. This possessiveness that's within him and how much he turns into this really creepy villain when he feels close to one of his victims. That's what you see from Funland. He has this this obsessive nature about him, which is why, I guess, what makes him a serial killer. But you hear about some of the other serial killers as well. And I think setting it this way, where you have that build up and you have the panels, which are creepy enough, but then getting individual serial killers explaining who they are and their modus operandi, you know, and then you layer it all together with Corinthian, the good doctor, and Nimrod surrounding this victim, and then Corinthian telling him what each one of them is going to do, because he says the three of them should hunt together and use this experience to learn about each other's methods, basically.
Exactly.
And it's really terrifying. Can you imagine being that guy sitting in the room being surrounded by three experienced serial killers who you know, because that's what you've been doing. You've been an investigative journalist who knows all about these people, and you're now surrounded by three of the most brutal. The keynote speaker and two of the leaders of this convention have got you cornered.
Philip really didn't think this through.
Not at all.
And, you know, little did he know that there would be an attraction there from a distance, and it's only through looking to get the Corinthian a drink and you know, learn more about him that the Corinthian sees that this is not the boogeyman as his name badge suggests.
I do still wonder, is there more to the Corinthian in this version of the show? Is there more that he's able to see through the world as it is? Is he more able to see who people really are? Because he's made lots of leaps over the course of the season. He's been able to find people that were not able to be found, like Ethel Cripps. He was able to find her pretty quickly when he needed to find her. He was able to get in contact with John Doe as he'd just come out of the asylum that he was in. Arkham Asylum, as we still think it was. But he was able to find all these people at exactly the right time. So I wonder, is there more to what Corinthian can see?
Maybe,
the man with no eyes.
I mean, some of it may be down to his victims. Mm. You know, I was wondering, had he killed the boogeyman at a previous time, so just knew that he was dead.
I know he's dead. Yeah, 3 years ago. Yeah,
exactly. I know he's dead. He's in a swamp somewhere in one of the southern states of America. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, with John Doe, I guess it's a bit more long term because he was also there at the Burgess house.
Yeah,
so he's probably keeping tabs on them because they are ultimately at that time. We're limiting Morpheus by having him trapped in the real world.
Yeah.
And then with having the helm, the pouch of sand and the ruby, he knows those are tools of Morpheus. But nonetheless, yes, it's just so good. It's kind of like, it's like this chain reaction of serial killing kicks off at the serial convention. And I just really, really just enjoyed how this was all constructed, even down to the last moment where Funland is killed by the Corinthian.
Yeah.
And you have the Corinthian saying to Rose and Jed, I mean, Jed is terrified out of his life, really, because he's just seen the person who rescues him kill someone else in the maintenance passages of the hotel. And the Corinthian just quite calmly says, "You're safe with me."
Yeah. You know,
like, really, really good.
Yeah. Yeah. So good. Oh, I'm so glad this was realized as well as it was for the show. Excellent stuff. Where else are we going to go in this episode? What's next? I think we need to talk about the seismic disturbances in the dreaming.
I think we do.
What exactly is happening with Lyta and Hector? I love how this followed on from last week, because this is, I mentioned it before, this is differently told to the comic book. But this idea of what actually is going on between Lyta and Hector, that Hector is actually a ghost, effectively, that hasn't traveled on to his destination after death, is really interesting. That Rose has pulled him into the dream world and he's actually a ghost living in there and hasn't passed on is a really interesting twist on what you think was happening. You thought Lyta was having a dream that was going on longer than it should be going on, but actually Hector is in existence in here.
Yeah, I love this as well. I mean, even just the opening of this, where Rose comes in and tells Lyta about her dream, and you know, you might think I'm crazy, and it's just Lyta saying, you know, no, I don't think you do. I believe everything you said, because, you know, look at me, and shows her bump to Rose.
Yeah.
I just thought that was a great moment where, you know, she's facing away from Rose and Rose is trying to have this kind of awkward conversation about this dream that she's had, met the Lord of Dreams, Morpheus, and can help her find her brother, thinking that she's just going to be told she's crazy. Yeah. You know, she's lost all sense of reality. And you just get simply back from Lyta, that, no, I believe you, you know, and shows what's happened, you know, because of her dreams.
And she's now fully pregnant, like, you know, the day before she wasn't pregnant.
Exactly. Yeah. And with Matthew watching on, you know, reporting back to Lucienne, there's this view of the weakening of the boundaries between the real world and the dream world. Mm-hmm. But again, with the effectively almost the falling out that happened between Morpheus and Lucienne, Lucienne's like, I don't care anymore. Yeah. You have to report directly to Morpheus.
I'm just a librarian.
I mean, really good. It just, like, following that thread through, I thought was really good. I just really like then how this, you know, sort of developed, because you have Lyta effectively, you know, wanting to live in her dreams, to give it a try, because there's not much of a life that I have here.
Oh.
You know, really sort of sad, really kind of desperate in many respects. But you see these events, with Lyta at least being with the spotlight on, seeing the different cracks that are beginning to, and fissures that are happening, both in her dream, but into the Morpheus's palace, and Morpheus trying to think what is going on here.
Yeah.
But kind of being still a bit unsure of Lucien's theory.
Yeah, but I do like that he goes to Lucien to ask if she has any more detail about her theory, or more theories that she might want to share with him, because he has no idea what's going on. He hasn't seen this either. You know, the concept here is that there have been vortexes in the past, vortexes in the past, but they've been dealt with, they've been sorted, they've been cut off, but he wanted to use the vortex for his purposes here. So that meant Rose has gotten more powerful than they've dealt with in the past. So he's not 100% sure that that's what's happening because he doesn't know anything about a vortex. They haven't gotten to this point before, which is really interesting. So it's almost caused by him because the minute he found out that Rose is a vortex, he could have ended it there. But yeah. Because it's allowed it to continue. And again, I'm speaking about it quite callously because that's how Morpheus thinks. Because he's allowed it to continue, Rose is now become a very powerful vortex.
Yeah.
And he may find out what that really means now. And nobody else has any idea what it is.
Exactly.
That's the challenge.
So. I must say as well, I really enjoyed Lucienne in this moment as well as Morpheus is asking for her help, where she plays hardball with
him.
She does. And it's really like, no, you didn't want me to do this. Mm-hmm. You just wanted me to be the librarian. I am being the librarian, yeah, like you told me and directed me to. And anything else than that, you were going to be a noise and mm-hmm. so on. So, you know, I love, as I said before, this ultimately leads to an apology of sorts, yeah, to Lucienne as Morpheus comes round to the idea that actually Lucienne has the finger on the pulse. Mm-hmm. She can help, and her talents aren't just in good library management and curation. Absolutely. Of the books that he holds. So I really enjoyed it.
Yeah, yeah. I love how Morpheus is acting around it because he just doesn't want to admit that he's wrong. He doesn't want to admit that somebody else could help him. Remember, he doesn't reach out to people for help. He doesn't like doing that.
No.
He wants to be the one in charge of everything because that's what it's been for the last number of millennia. He's been the one in charge. So the idea that he would have to deign to ask one of the members of the Dreaming for help or information that could help him is really making him cringe inside. And I like how Lucienne is twisting that. But what we do learn from the rest of the residents, the other people that we meet here, from Fiddler's Green going, well, Morpheus has changed quite clearly because he's apologized to you. When did Morpheus apologize to anybody?
Yeah.
You know, and Merv saying that this is exactly how he has always acted. This is exactly how Morpheus has always acted over the centuries. He's always been like that, but he's been gone for a century. You think he's changed? No, he's exactly the same as he always has been. So why are you holding it against him? Why are you finding it weird that he's like that? Maybe you've just forgotten that this is what he's like. But it does lead to the brutality almost in this episode of how Sandman ends Lyta's dream. The idea that a regular human from the waking world would shut themselves off and sit themselves in the dreaming and make that choice is completely against what the dreaming is. So
yeah,
he has to stop that. That has to stop. It doesn't matter about her crying and Rose protesting because she thinks there's some connection between the two of them. Morpheus has to stop that because it can't exist. You can't have a living human being sitting in the dreaming and creating their own life inside there because they will die in the waking world. So he has to stop that, and he does it as brutally as you could by snapping his fingers and sending the ghost of her dead husband, who she was going to spend her time with in this dreaming world,
yeah,
sending him off to whatever continues after he died.
Yeah, it was a great effect as well, almost like with the snap, you know, but even finer, I think, because it almost like sand, like Morpheus's sand, sort of, it's like it was like Hector was being sort of sandblasted effectively, like this abrasiveness of just how it sort of starts to deconstruct into these fine particles to the skull, you know, whilst Lyta is pleading to this person that has effectively inserted himself in. I love the fact when they arrive in, it's like, who's this?
Yeah,
you know, exactly. Lord Morpheus is there, has inserted himself into Lyta's dream.
Mm-hmm.
And she doesn't know who he is, and then begins telling her that, you know, he died long ago. He belongs to death,
yes,
not in the dream world. You know, your husband cannot be a dream.
Mm-hmm.
And this is not his role, in effect, his function.
It's gone. He's gone. He's,
and so just and
without him gone, she can't deal with with her mourning. She can't deal with the grief that she has from losing him. That's why that line is so important in the waking world when she's talking to Rose and saying, well, I'm going to go and live my life in the dreaming with Hector, because I have nothing here. Well, she doesn't even grieve for her husband. She hasn't moved on in any way from the death of her husband. Exactly. We saw that when they were traveling over to the UK to visit Unity and Kincaid. Yeah. She was having dreams of her husband sitting beside her and that she hadn't even thought about him no longer being there. So again, while it may seem massively brutal, I mentioned it on last week's episode, while it may seem massively brutal what Morpheus has done, this is not how dreams work, is a really important fixture here. What happened last week was he took away that pocket dream universe from Jed because Jed wasn't able to use dreams to deal with the fears and horrors that come with his what he's dealing with in the real world. Here we have Lyta escaping her grieving for her dead husband in a place that shouldn't exist.
It's different aims, isn't it? Mm. And he has a completely different perspective on what's going on compared to Lyta and even Rose, you know. Mm-hmm. And that's the kind of interesting thing here as well, is Rose is this hugely powerful dream vortex that can impact the dream world,
yes,
potentially destroying it. And yet, in some respects, she is ignorant about the reasons for its existence.
Mm-hmm.
And this is where then Morpheus and Rose then butt heads, really, mm-hmm. and their relationship, becomes strained, because he says, you know, this dream is over to Lyta, and Rose follows him to his palace after he's stopped Lyta's dream, mm-hmm. and removed Hector from the dreaming. And effectively, she gives him a warning and tells Morpheus to leave her universe alone, and riposts with the same words, this dream is over, and leaves his palace as mm-hmm. easily as she came in.
Yeah.
And I just thought that it was just really, really good. I mean, real sense of, almost equivalent power here. Not necessarily saying she is equivalent, but almost, you know, in the sense of the ease by which she is able to move through dreams, mm-hmm. as we saw in the last episode, but now at will, almost doesn't need Morpheus's help, and yet mm-hmm. has an ignorance about the whole situation of the different realms.
Absolutely, which is part of the reason why she may destroy the dream realm, because she doesn't know what it really is, and she doesn't know how much power she has. So that was how she was introduced back from Desire talking to Despair back in episode 7, this idea of the vortex being there could destroy Morpheus and his realm. So it very much could be, because she doesn't understand, because she wants her friend to be happy, and her friend had decided to be happy, I'm going to live in the dream world with the ghost of a dead husband, and she's affronted by that. That could be how the dreaming ends, effectively. This could put the two of them on a collision course, which kills dreams. So I love this. It's such an ethereal concept, almost. It's a concept I'd never, ever thought about before reading The Sandman. And I love how it's been brought to life here on the screen, because you can tell the tension between the two things, that a concept versus the reality of what's going on in the waking world are dealt with really well here, I think.
Well, that's it. And in some respects, even the fact that Rose pulls dreams towards her,
mm-hmm.
she may have no control herself.
Absolutely.
of whether and what she destroys, this weakening of the boundaries. Yeah. She's not actively looking to do that. That's a result of all these dreams coming and spiraling around her, being pulled into her. And so now you have her angry at Morpheus because mm-hmm. of what he's done to her friend and the distress, even though Morpheus's reasons for doing it are absolutely sound.
Yeah.
So again, really, really interesting.
And will the walls between the worlds break down even more, and we'll see some of the dreaming in the waking world?
Well, exactly.
Yeah, I wonder if that might happen in the final episode of the season. But we kind of have talked about the major points. We talked about the serial convention. We've talked about what happens with Lyta and Hector, and the punishment of Sandman, and the kind of butting of heads between Sandman and Rose. But there's one additional punishment that Sandman has for Lyta there as well. Not only does he take away the ghost of her dead husband. He does allow her to keep the child that's inside her. She's still pregnant in the waking world, but he leaves her with an extra threat, which is that that child is mine because it's of the dreaming, and I someday will come and take it away from you.
Yes.
Ooh, that's a pretty brutal thing to do. He could have effectively just cancelled out what happened in the dream, right? He could have just gone, well, you're not pregnant because you got pregnant in the dream world, so that's gone. That's coming back into my realm. But he's saying, you carry it, it's yours, but it will be mine because it was born in the dream world. That's a,
yeah,
that's almost a threat to Lyta for what she did by trying to stay in the dream world.
Well, I mean, I guess this is where I'm not entirely sure, because yes, it was conceived in the dream world, or, you know, but it transferred over to the reality, or to the waking world, where time and time again, Morpheus has said, you know, I can't go there.
Mm-hmm.
It can only be in dreams. And so there is a reality there in the waking world that Morpheus can't deal with in that sense. But I don't know. I don't know in that sense how that works, because similarly then it would be the same with Unity Kincaid, potentially, well, with her mom, if that's how it played out.
Yeah.
But maybe, again, he's on a different time scale to humans, so he may just never have gotten round to reclaim it.
Yeah.
Because there's other things going on.
Yeah, well, basically, remember, Unity had a daughter who's passed away. Unity's daughter had a daughter who's Rose's mom, who's passed away. All gone before Sandman returned from his exile. And now Rose is a vortex, so there's nothing to take back into the dreaming, really. I would say that's how I'd explain it. Whereas here, Lyta's come out pregnant from the dreaming, and he said, you can keep your child, but that child of the dreaming was created here. Therefore, like Corinthian, like Fiddler's Green, like Galt, they're all part of the dreaming, so Sandman, Morpheus can come and take them back to the dream.
Yeah, and Morpheus can move into the real world, because we've seen that with Joanna Constantine and with the guy from, you know, 13...
Hobgoblin, yes.
Hobgoblin.
Yeah.
So he can do that, but again, he hasn't taken... As I say, I don't really know the rules here.
But they're not of the dreaming, whereas he's saying, this child that she's conceived was conceived in the dreaming. So like a dream that he has created, this child has been created within the dreaming.
But it's more than that now, because it's had the impact of Rose. So it's also a child of the waking world or reality, because it's passed through.
It's passed through because she weakened the walls between dreaming and the waking world.
So it is. Okay.
Yeah,
but anyway, that's a little douchebaggery from the Sandman. But as I say, I wasn't entirely sure how it worked, because effectively, it had taken form as well in the waking world.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of nothing had really come out of around Unity Kincaid. So I wasn't sure of what rules around this were in place.
Hey, there are no rules. There are no rules.
Well, there is because Morpheus is a bit of a stickler for the old rules, to be honest.
I have to say, there was a great headline to an article in one of those clickbait type articles of how do superpowers work. You've seen those for every show that we've covered. There's a great one on Morpheus today. Was how do the Sandman's powers work? And it's, look, they just work because the writer said that's how they work. He's very, very powerful. It's basically the description that was there. Good stuff. I think that's it for the episode overall. Is there any other notes, anything else that we didn't talk about?
I've just got one note. I just thought it was a really nice exchange, actually, between the Corinthian to Jed, actually. First of all, we see him getting Jed an ice cream. So for Jed, it's, you know, all his Christmases have come at once, especially given what he's been used to. But I like how Corinthian, you know, again, his manipulative side, just the I'm running away too, he says to Jed. When we meet Rose, we don't have to run anymore. You know, so a nice little line there from the Corinthian to both placate Jed and deflect his questions, but also effectively speaking his truth a bit. I mean, what is it almost that they say? If you're going to lie, you say a version of the truth, and that's his version of the truth. In order, it's not to lie, it's more to deflect.
Yeah.
Because Jed starts asking a few questions, you know, about how he knows Rose and so on. So I just thought that was a really nice little moment at the service stop with the ice creams.
Yeah. I also like how he deflects when asked for his name from Jed as well, where he's kind of goes, oh, well, you know, you don't really need my name, because isn't it only when people are angry with you that they call your name? Just like Uncle Barnaby, basically, is what Jed picks up almost immediately from that exchange. So never giving out his name to either Rose or to Jed in the episode. But I love how he diverts that question. Good stuff. Excellent, Corinthian. Once again, having some great moments, particularly in this episode. This is his big one, I think, for the series. Got lots to do here. But overall, John, what did you think of the Sandman Chapter 9 Collectors?
I really enjoyed it. I give it 5 Weetabix nightmares out of 5.
Very good.
Both because Weetabix literally is the nightmare cereal of sawdust compressed into a block.
Very good. That's why you chose a non-Kellogg cereal.
I guess we could say all bran nightmares, I guess, which I was sadly forced to eat when I stayed with my gran as she was upping her fiber intake as she got older. But yes, I guess that would be one of the nightmare cereals for sure. As well as a serial killer nightmare, I guess. but yeah, I really enjoyed this. Loved the convention. I love that playing out. I think Lyta's story with Hector just really, dare I say, it came to life here.
Yeah.
I think it did in the last episode, but it's just the extension of that. It's links to Rose. It's weakening of the boundaries. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, as you were saying, certainly episode 8 and 9 to me can just be fused together as some big episode. I thought everything about it was just great all the way through. I love the reveal of Fiddler's Green as Gilbert. I just enjoyed the convention, just all these different elements happening in this hotel, whether it is the organization committee, the arrival of Corinthian and Jez, the arrival of Gilbert and Rose, all really good. And then linked in with Lyta and this sort of big strain and schism that's occurred now between Rose and Morpheus, and you're just there going, okay, this is what the Corinthian can exploit here. However, I say that, I don't know how you can turn around being seen to kill someone twice. You know, it's shocking for Jed, and it's certainly shocking for Rose in this moment. So I don't quite know how you smooth talk your way out of this, but I'm guessing he probably needs Rose's eyes as much as anything. I don't know how is he going to utilize Rose, and that's why I can't wait to get on to chapter 10.
Yes. Saying nothing. I want to see how it plays out. But he could possibly just threaten Jed to get to Rose. That could be a way that he might do it.
Yeah.
But yeah, maybe there's another way. Maybe he certainly is such a sweet talker. We've seen the way he's gotten in and out of situations.
Great intrigue for this final episode, you know, of this 4-episode arc. So I'd give this 5 Weetabix nightmares out of 5.
Fantastic. Fantastic.
Derek, what are your thoughts on chapter 9?
Love this. Absolutely love this. Seeing the serial killer convention come to life after something that really stood out from the comic books. I think they did a great job here, even though it's not as hidden as it was in the comic books, and it wasn't as massive a reveal, or at least it was when I was reading it back in the early 90s. It felt like this massive reveal of, oh, a serial convention for serial killers. I get it. I'm up with the jokes. But I think it worked really well in here that it's some great some great comedy with it, but also the tension that was building throughout for both Jed and for this journalist that's in there. I thought that was really well told within the story. And then to continue the story within the dreaming of what's happening with the people surrounding Rose was really interesting. So really excited to see how they're going to close out the season with episode 10. We have got the extra episode 11 that we'll be covering as well, of course, but that's post season, I suppose. So this arc is the arc. So how is it going to close out for the season? Looking forward to that as well.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
Good stuff. Let's get on to some of your thoughts about Chapter 9. If you want to send us in any feedback, you can email us to feedback@tvpodcastindustries.com or join us over in our Facebook group at facebook.com/groups/TV Podcast Industries, where you can leave your thoughts on any of the spoiler posts for the shows that we're covering. First up, Dr. Bob Phillips says, thoroughly despicable and quite well organized. I was very impressed with the serial team. This feels like the third in a little trio within the season. And while it clears us of uncertainties about Jed, and of course a green is embodied as the most English of men, we are also given a little more discomfort with the Dream Lord. He's a bit of a knob sometimes.
That's exactly what I said to Derek about Morpheus after watching it. Word, he's a bit of a knob. Word. Yeah. Yeah. Word for word. So totally on the same page there, Dr. Bob, about Morpheus. Although I think in the discussions I get why he can't allow Hector and Lyta to do what they're doing.
Yeah, you can't have a ghost and a human from the waking world live in the dreaming.
At least within the rules that he has, abiding by, in that sense. But he also doesn't realize that seeing your dead husband, in effect, die again by being sort of sandblasted out of existence is probably not good for Lyta.
He's all about ripping off that plaster,
John. He really, really is. Yeah, exactly.
Excellent stuff. Thanks, Dr. Bob. I hope we're going to hear from you about your thoughts about the finale, the final episode of these 10 episodes and the 11th episode later on the season.
Yeah, good stuff. Thanks, Bob. Coffee and Vodka says, greetings, fellow Ghost Daddy defenders. Ooh. The concepts of survival, hope, and change continue in this episode and series of long-form poetry disguised as horror, fantasy, and adventure. The object of travel is not to visit a foreign land, but to at last set foot in your own country as a foreign land.
Love it.
A thing of beauty with an Easter eggy double meaning rewarding the reader while taking nothing away from the viewer. This and the coming together of characters and story elements to the convention center using the vortex to its fullest potential shows a lot of well-layered writing effort. Morpheus's struggle in having to give up his ego and micromanaging ways, Lucienne's peak at being demoted, and their uncomfortable yet warm reconciliation was nicely brought off. Rose's unobtrusive, then aggressively present central role in all events was orchestrated almost operatically. In contrast, as vitally important as Lyta's role is in the series, her portrayal here is mostly forgetful. Picking up the slack, the Corinthian spins what he hopes is an effective web against his creator. Finally, as easy as it would be to give Stephen Fry the MVP in every episode he's in, it belongs to Danny Corain's Funland for supplying both the show's creep factor and its tense, scary ending. Five burnt chicken fingers, devious double entendres, and blade-embedded, bloody, bogus bogeymen out of five. Peace and take care, Coffee and Vodka. I wholeheartedly agree with every sentiment there. Yeah. I think really, really good. And yeah, I just think how this all spirals its way together in this episode is phenomenally good. And I mean, the quote you take from Gilbert as and then how that links to him as Fiddler's Green is just nicely like done by Gaiman. But what else do you expect, really? He's an excellent story writer and teller, and he's also good at just mixing up the obvious so well, I think.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Such a beautiful, beautiful concept that he's put on screen here. I love your description there, Coffee and Vodka, of long-form poetry disguised as horror, fantasy, and adventure. I mentioned that earlier on in the season when we were talking about episode 5, 24/7, where it's a really brutal horror, horrific episode, difficult to watch, difficult to read through, but important in its own sense because it is difficult sometimes. Life is difficult sometimes. Things are really awful, and that's kind of a story that needs to be told. And Neil Gaiman never shies away from doing that, telling a story that needs to be told. He doesn't avoid telling the bad things that happen in the world. So I love that the show's been able to do that, but I mentioned back then that when that issue came out, it suddenly became this horror book that people were reading, waiting for the next horrific thing to happen. And that doesn't happen very often. So I'm glad the show represents all those elements, the horror, the fantasy, the adventure of it. But it's all in this beautifully poetic way put on screen. So here's hoping for more seasons.
Well, absolutely. Yeah. And Derek, mm-hmm. Does this mean I now like poetry?
Well, good poetry, I think you've always liked. Bad poetry, I think most of us all hated.
No, not really.
Let's say poetic yes, rather than poetry.
Yes, I think that's probably better. Right. I can rest easy once again.
Excellent. Thanks so much for your feedback, and thanks so much for your thoughts. Thanks for staying with us for The Sandman. We are still on holidays at the moment, as you listen to this. We should be back next week.
Chink.
Yes, I hope. I hope we'll be on the beach having some drinks. But we will be back next week with our discussion about the season finale of The Sandman, episode 10, Lost Hearts. There is an episode 11. I'm not making that, not getting that wrong, but episode 11 is outside of the season. We'll talk about that on a future episode, but we will be talking about chapter 10, Lost Hearts, next time. So get in your final thoughts on that part of the season. If you want to, you can email us to feedback@tvpodcastindustries. We want to hear from you about what you thought about the 10 episode season, and then tell us what you thought about The Dream of a Thousand Cats and Calliope.
Yes, and fellow dreamers, please stay subscribed to the podcast for all things The Sandman, and why not share it with your friends, because sharing the podcast is sharing the love.
Yes,
indeed. But with that, thank you so much, fellow dreamers, for joining us. Mm-hmm. It is great discussing great TV shows with great listeners and followers of the podcast and the shows, great fans, in fact.
Exactly.
Remember, in between time though, keep watching, keep listening, and keep dreaming.
Bye.
Nighty night.